Now, every game has rules, and those rules are set up by game designers. What you might not know is that those rules also apply to animation, and design and animation need to work really close together to actually set up those rules. How fast can a character walk? Or how fast can a character run? How high can a character jump? All of these things need metrics. Now, this is called, more specifically, animation metrics. And in this video, I'd like to explain how useful they are to you, the game animator, or the potential game animator in the future, and how you have to work with design to establish these metrics so you can then animate and build a game based on these metrics and these world rules. Let's go. All right, welcome to another video. I'm glad you're here. If you're new here, my name is Harvey Newman. I like to share all things games, animation, and game making here in this channel with all of you. If you're not subscribed, at the end of this video, if you enjoyed it, please consider subscribing, giving it a like, and definitely comment below with your thoughts. Now, animation metrics is something that doesn't get mentioned not nearly enough, and is something that is so useful and powerful, and is mentioned pretty much daily in games development. Like, as you start the game, when you are in pre-production, which is before you proper develop the game and you're just exploring the game, those things don't matter so much. So you're just designing some things, throwing basically animations and art to the wall to see if it sticks, to see what works in a game. But by the time you hit production, where you already know the rules and establishment of the game and how the game is going to be, you need to start establishing some rules that the game is going to follow in order to make sure that the world makes sense. And this is what normally a designer is used to. This is the role of a designer, and this world needs to have certain types of rules, and this designer needs to think about the rules that this world has, and then the player needs to live in it and basically make it as believable as possible. And then us, all of us game developers, animators, artists, engineers, and all that stuff, we start populating this world based on these rules. Now, in more specific terms, for animation, those metrics matter a lot. And also for art, those metrics matter a lot. And a lot of the times, depending on the studio, these metrics can be a little bit fluid. And the reason why is because designers are thinking about the feel of the game, how fast is the game, how do I want the player to feel, and they're looking for other games for inspiration, and they're looking for how can we jazz up things so we can make our game original and our game unique. And therefore, they are basically just, you know, thinking broadly about the game. Now enter art and animation, and then we start asking questions of designers about, okay, so you want the character to kind of like run up the wall, but how tall can a wall be? And when would the player like run out of stamina up the wall? Can he run up a wall infinitely? Can he actually run up a 2-meter wall? Or can he jump over a ledge of a certain height? Can he sit in certain chairs? So that's basically what animation and art are asking, for different reasons. Normally art is asking so they know how to model things to scale. So this world needs to have a scale. It could be maybe like Spider-Man. You have a whole lot of New York, even that New York that lives within Spider-Man the game, that New York needs to be at a specific scale in comparison to Spider-Man the character, right? So art is looking for those metrics so they can build a world to scale so it makes sense. But then us, as animators, we are looking for those metrics so we know how to animate things to a specific metric. So this is when basically objects and animations come together so they can actually basically interact with each other. And this can be anything from you grabbing the knob of a door and turning it, or it can be you sitting down in a chair. It could be you like running up the wall, like I just mentioned before, or vaulting over an object or anything like that. So I have here my iPad so I can show you guys a little bit about some examples of how we establish these metrics in practice in game development. Now, let's say that we have an idle for an animation, and now we kind of are starting to understand how does the character locomote over space in the game. Now, you can just create a walk and a run and a sprint, throw it in and see what happens. But it's much better to kind of like figure out things on paper, and then at least you have something that makes sense. And then you can create the animations based off that and then tweak things after the fact. So one of the things that you first do is find out how how fast is a walk in any game? So as you actually are, you find out that the world is a certain metric because it's really big or really small, and then you realize that your walk is actually pretty good, or you think the walk is going to be pretty good at 1 meter per second. So that is the your walk. So now you create the animation, you test the walk, you find out that it's either too fast, too slow, you change those metrics. And then after the fact, you realize that actually what you need is basically 2 meters per second. This will be a very fast walk. You probably need more than that, but 2 meters per second now feels good. So now we have a base to start from. And then you move on to the next natural thing, which is your runs. So now you have your runs. So the runs, to start, obviously, you're gonna go twice as fast. So you kind of go 2 meters per second. So the run is gonna be 4 meters per second on your run. So that's basically your run. You create your run, you test it out, but you realize that this game is a little bit stylistic. So you want the run to be a little bit faster than 4 meters per second. So you realize that actually you want your run to be about 6 meters per second. So now you establish the baseline for your run. If the walk is like three times the run, then obviously the sprint needs to be the same, right? So we are going to actually get to the sprint, which is going to be about, we're going to start with a 12 meters per second for your sprint. And we have the run and the walk. So for your sprint, you have 12 meters per second. You go ahead and test out your 12 meters per second. But once again, this game is stylistic, so you want it even faster. So maybe you want 15 frames per second or 15 meters per second or something along those lines. So you get to that number once again, and then you realize that this feels good for the game that we're making. Now we have that established, good to go. Amazing. So now you have a baseline for the main player character in your game. Now everything spans from this main player character because the enemies are going to be attacking the main player character. The main player character is going to be going up the walls. The main player is going to be jumping off things and stuff. So you can start to see that it's really important to make sure that everything stems from the main player. You sort out those metrics for the main player. And then if you have enemies, if you have creatures, if you have anything else, they need to basically adapt to the main player. Now we're talking about gameplay design, and I found this really amazing course by Lucas Ridley called Video Game Design in Unreal Engine. You guys should absolutely check it out. It's in today's sponsor's website called Skillshare, which I highly recommend as they have a ton of different classes, including this one by Lucas, where you actually find the fundamentals of how to set up your animations in Engine. Lucas himself, he's an animator. He's talking through the lens of an animator on how you can actually start implementing your animations in Unreal Engine with animation systems on top of it, which is incredibly clutch for anybody that is looking to learn more about Unreal. Now, Skillshare, for me, at least whenever I want to learn about something new, it's definitely one of the places that I go to, and 9 times out of 10, I find what I need in Skillshare, and there's always a course that is interesting and piques my interest that I bookmark for later, since they have so many choices. To make things easier, they have smart class categories, which makes it much easier for you to find things that you like depending on what you do. So for us 3D artists comes in incredibly clutch because you can actually look for classes based on the software of your preference, perhaps if you're an artist, on the material that you use. So you end up finding much more of what you like in Skillshare. Now they have lots more to offer. If you're interested in film like myself, they have a bunch of stuff there. Entrepreneurship is something that I'm heavily into since YouTube and making my own business. So if you're interested in knowing more, definitely hop on, check out Skillshare if you haven't so far. And the first 500 people to use the link in the description will get a whole free month of Skillshare for free so you can test the waters. Thank you so much for Skillshare for sponsoring the video. Let's go back to it. Now, this is basically to do with basic metrics for animations. Now, it gets really complex from here. The next best step is going to be to collaborate with art. Now, I'm going to show you here quickly in Maya an example based off this fella here. He's actually sitting down on a bench or a seat, let's say, right? And one of the first things that happens is, and it happens normally at the beginning of production, you start questioning like, okay, so I know he has to sit down. I can clean up this animation and just kind of like put something under him and get him to sit down. However, I think that would defeat the purpose and it would actually get to be twice as hard as it should be. Now, if you have an experienced lead or an experienced director, most likely they'll pick up on this straight away and say, we need to speak with art so we can get some metrics sorted out before we do the animation. Otherwise, we have to double the work. But if you are new, most likely you have to go through this to understand that you need to actually set some metrics before you start your animations. So hopefully you start to understand why these things are so important. Now, we speak with art and realize that we kind of try some stuff. Let's say art says, we're not sure. Can you give us something that basically sounds good or like looks good for animation? We're like, sure, okay, we'll actually set up a little bench or a little seat for the guy, and we'll say that, you know, maybe like this much is actually good enough. Let me just create a plane right quick, and then so you can understand exactly where I'm going with this. So we have here this guy, he's sitting down, and his butt is pretty much inside. So this is the final pose, and I like where this is going. This kind of looks natural. So we measure this and we give it to art. Now, measuring things and giving round numbers is incredibly important. So as I was explaining about the metrics of the run, the walk, the sprint, you realize that I was actually giving you round numbers all the time. And the same is true for objects. As much round numbers as you can get, the better it is. So this is about 40 centimeters, and I think that's fine. So now I actually go back to art and say, in a document perhaps, that this chair, we are happy with 40. So please go ahead and do your thing and maybe create an object in this scale. Now, art can create this object, come back to you and realize that actually this is too small, this is too big, can we make it 60? Then you start a negotiation and a talk about exactly what makes sense. Now, there is an extra layer of complication because you have to involve engineer at certain points in order to solve certain issues. And for that, I have to go to the trusty iPad again so I can show you what I mean. So here on this iPad, we're gonna talk about jumping. Now, this involves engineering for one simple reason. So everything that I mentioned before still applies here. Certain ledges or certain walls that can be jumped, they need to be a certain width. They need to be separated by a certain distance. So that distance, you need to have a round number here. You need to have a round number for how far is this ledge, because you're gonna have one animation here. So this is gonna be one anim of him kind of like jumping off. And then you're gonna have to have a certain amount of animations as you jump. And then you're gonna have another animation for the landing. This is gonna be another animation here. So you're gonna have a takeoff and a landing animation. You're sure about that, but how far can you jump off, right? So you need to find out when to trigger that animation, and then when to trigger that animation, and then when to trigger the going back to the regular locomotion, because you need to come out of that jump at some point. But this is where it becomes tricky, because the distance of the jump can change, and you can have set numbers. So you create different variations of jumps. So this is kind of how we used to do it many years ago. And you basically create a jump for maybe, let's say that this here is a meter jump, right? So you have 1 meter, 1 meter here. And then this one here is 2 meters, right? And maybe have a third one with 3 meters. So now we can create two different animations in this case, or three different animations of him jumping over a meter, and then of him or her jumping over 2 meters. So that's basically what you have to create in order to build a basic logic on jump. But in today's games, this really doesn't make sense, because designers want flexibility, and we also want flexibility to make sure that not everything is boxed in and not everything looks the same, because the player, as you play, and you probably understand this, when you see things of the same distance and you do it a number of times, it becomes kind of boring, right? So you want to make sure that the player can actually judge the jump and basically try to jump a little bit further away, or maybe just make the edge. And for that, we need engineering so we can actually calculate that jump and have different parabolas, which is basically this movement here, right? That basically allow you to you will have different animations and different loops as you go through from beginning to end. So what happens here is that you create a loop animation that is basically being played. You have the intro, you have the outro, sometimes you have variations of this loop, and this loop can be extended almost like a rubber band to make sure that it goes further away or shorter than you actually had it intentionally. And it means that you can then have the illusion that you have more than two animations that are happening at any one point. You still need to create variations of the animation for a certain distance, but you have basically like more now that you can actually cater for the animator and for the player. Now, this is really, really cool, and most likely you're starting to understand that this gets really complex, but hopefully it gives you an understanding of how important metrics are for games. Every single game that you have played has some type of metrics, and the world needs to make sense. And this idea that the world is something that needs to have a specific measurement is something that you have to think about as a games developer, and it's something that really doesn't occur to you until you spend quite a few years working in games. So I don't know, maybe a Fallout or a game that big, like an open world game, Elden Ring, you can imagine that they must have spent a lot of time thinking about these things. And if you pay careful attention to a lot of these games, you realize that the amount of interactions that happen in a game, normally the bigger the game, the more they get limited, because having doors that you have to physically push and having seats that you have to like sit down at a specific height, it almost becomes too much of an anchor for certain games. So Elden Ring, if you think about it, open world game, most of the time you're just running, most of the time you have doors that open for you, and you know, like the metrics sometimes don't make a lot of sense because you can jump with a horse to a certain height, but they would have had to set up that metric. But for them, the locomotion aspect of the game is much more important than having these specific, like, you know, interactivity elements to the game. But then if you look for a game that is much more slow, for example, a first-person games are normally really big in this, so a Uncharted, for example, or Spider-Man, there is much more interactivity with the world, so they need to anchor these things much more into reality and have these things absolutely solid so they can replicate it. So Spider-Man 1, and this is just me assuming, but based on my experience, Spider-Man 1 would have been incredibly difficult to create from Insomniac because they have to set up all these rules and make sure that this world makes absolute sense. But then Spider-Man 2, they already have the metrics, and now they just have to focus on designing around what they have already and making the game better, which is so much better for all of us, right? Animators know exactly what they need to do, artists know exactly what they need to do, and it's just much more enjoyable overall. So I hope that made sense. Now, before I go, I want to give a quick shout out to somebody that left me a really good message on LinkedIn. Somebody called Eduardo. Eduardo, thank you so much. Eduardo basically comes from Puerto Rico, and he actually mentioned that even though there's not a lot of animators in Puerto Rico, he wanted to make sure that I would know that this content is actually incredibly inspiring and is helping the animators over there. So shout out to Puerto Rico. Thank you very much for all the good vibes, and I'm glad that you guys enjoying the content. Now, I want to ask you a question. Can you comment down below where you guys come from? Because every year or so I ask this question, and I'm always super psyched to see the different parts of the world that people come from. So let me know in the comments, what part of the world do you come from? Shout out to everybody that is supporting me on YouTube through my subscriptions. Don't forget to subscribe if you're interested in knowing more of this. And drop a like, drop a comment, let me know, talk to me. And if you stayed all the way through, I highly appreciate you. Thank you so much. Drop a comment down below. Let me know what you think about this content. And as always, stay well, stay safe. Peace.